Deborah.
Yeah, Jerry.
What are we doing in bed together?
I thought you were talking about relationships.
Well, yes, but not all relationships are quite so intimate.
Oh, how awkward. Maybe we should get out of bed then.
2, 1, you're rolling.
Jerry, as the good together guru, you bring to our attention the fact that, yeah, relationships aren't just about those intimate relationships. It impacts everything you do in the workplace, you know, driving down the street when you're in rush hour traffic and somebody cuts you off. It's like all about that relationship.
That's true. Oh, that's an excellent point, too. You know, when people cut each other off in traffic, what you have to realize is they certainly don't know you. They're not targeting you.
Oh, no,
you
I make up a whole story. I'm like, he cut me off because he doesn't like me.
But that's exactly how people react. They take it so personally. It's like, oh, this person, you know, has done something to me personally. The reality is, I mean, obviously, that person is frustrated. It's fairly sad when you think about it, because they're so frustrated in their life. They have no control over anything of meaning. So what do they have to do? They lash out at someone who cannot do anything back to them. You know, it's like going home and kicking the dog. It's really pathetic when you think about it. You know, but that's all that they can do, because they're not communicating with the people who are frustrating them.
Yeah, and a lot of that comes from, and I think we sometimes forget that a lot of stuff is set in stone early on, but a lot of that comes from our relationships with those who were around us, how we grew up, how we felt about those people that we looked up to, the people that were supposed to nurture us.
Well, like I say, now, the first thing that people do is when they talk about relationships, we talk about two or more people. But in fact, a relationship is the individual. It's your relationship with yourself first and foremost. And you really have to start with you as an individual before you get off into you with other people. Mm-hmm. So, and like you say, the point that you're making is that, yes, from a young age, and it's pretty much from the age of 3 to 7 years old, our personalities are set. Well, our personalities are set by our environment, the people around us. So it's our parents, authorities, and what we do with parents and authorities, we learn how to imitate or emulate. You know, we see them and then we say, okay, so are you telling me that when I'm in that position, you know, I need to react that way? If someone upsets me, I need to yell. The three-year-old child who you turn around and say, no, 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 and then they turn to the dog and say, no, no, no.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, okay, now I'm the authority and I'm going to, you know, it rolls downhill. It's like, okay, well, you talk to me, now I'm going to go talk to someone else who can't talk back, you know, who I have authority over. So when you're an authority figure, you're just imitating what you've learned from authorities. You also imitate or learn what is expected of you in society. And that's as a child, as a subordinate. So when someone is talking to you and they are the authority, then how are you supposed to respond?
Respectfully.
Well, possibly.
Yeah.
But one of the things is, okay, you know, you're in a room by yourself, you're a child, and you break a lamp, and your mother walks in.
The dog did it.
And says, but no, exactly. Your mother asks you, who did this? But you're the only person in the room. Now, certainly she's smarter than this. So she's playing a game with you. Now, you're not, you know, thinking of that she's playing a game, but you're trying to figure out, what is she asking? So yes, you do come up with, well, it must have been the dog, it must have been the wind.
Yeah.
You're being put in a position to where you're fabricating stories. Why? Because you're being tempted to fabricate the story. Someone is putting you in a position of saying, hey, I'm not just going to come out and say, you did this, why did you do it, what happened? I'm not going to be straightforward and clear with you.
Yeah.
You know, it's all these masked communications that we have.
And then there's that moment in our life where we think, you know what, I have an opinion. And oftentimes that kind of brews around those teenage years, college years, and your parents are like, I didn't raise you like this.
Well, exactly. Like I say, that's the third position. So you're either acting as an authority or you're acting as a subordinate, but there's that intermediate position, that neutral position, where you're actually acting independently and you're having your own thoughts regardless of what is expected of you or what you think should be done, you know, so you're in that middle ground, that third position.
When you talked about relationships, you know, start with you knowing yourself, it's a responsibility that we need to take. You have to be honest with yourself. You know, there are people I know who are always getting fired from jobs, and like, I don't know why they keep firing me. Or people who always, you know, they have a boyfriend for a month and they're like, I don't know why guys just keep breaking up with me. You know, they become, right. It's what people are doing to you. You got to ask yourself, well, what are you doing?
Well, actually, yeah, that's along with those three positions that you learn as a child, there's how we interact, and that's a drama triangle. There's this triangle that says that there's a persecutor, and a victim, and a rescuer. Now, obviously, the victim needs a persecutor in order to be a victim. Mm-hmm. Now, some are truly victims. You know, there really are people who are persecuting others. But there are a group of people who are self-defined victims. They find persecutors where there are none, so they don't have to take responsibility for anything. Exactly, it's like, why am I always getting fired? Well, take responsibility. What did you do? You know, did you do something? And then there's the rescuer who comes along and has to save the victim. And some victims are looking for rescuers. As a matter of fact, if you think about it, if you think about an affair, what's an affair? Well, one person says, oh, I'm being victimized. I'm not loved enough. She doesn't care. They don't understand or whatever. So I'm a victim. And I go and find a rescuer, and really that's the affair partner. The affair partner comes along and says, oh, you poor dear. Oh, I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to save you from that other person. So you're going to rescue me, okay? So affairs follow that victim, rescuer, persecutor triangle.
Yeah. But we also find that in relationships in the workplace. You know, every office has that person who's the hero. Don't mind me. I'll stay late and eat through lunch and dinner. I'll get it done, right? Because I need that. Oh, you're so good, you know? And then there's that person who is, you know, very demanding and can be very controlling and micromanaging, but yet just has, you know, seems to have no compassion or empathy or sympathy for the rest of the office.
Right, right. Like I say, some victims don't actually need a rescuer.
Yeah.
They just want to be the victim at all times. So there's no one who could rescue them. And you know, there's nothing that can be done for them. Like say, they're always, you know, saying, oh, woe is me, you know, my life is so horrible. But there's nothing that anyone can do.
Yeah. The other thing I want to touch on is how important it is for us to kind of have a basic understanding of relationships, because it does impact our life. Even if you think your whole family, your spouse, or whatever, your job, everything's perfect there, you can even look outwardly to things like politicians who set policy for you, who do certain things. We are all impacted by someone's view of themselves and how good or not good they are with somebody else.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's it. All this information that we're talking about actually spans all relationships. You know, too often when you talk about relationships, people jump to the mindset of, oh, it's an intimate relationship. It's as if that's the only relationship there is. But everything that we do that is, like say, with someone else and even with ourselves is a relationship. And a lot of these things have a lot of commonalities. So if we understand some of these base facts, we can apply them across the board to all of our relationships and start to understand how other people are relating to us or how we're relating to them.
Yeah. And with that said, you know, most of our personalities are set by a certain age. It doesn't mean that we can't take things, learn from it, and change our direction. And that's kind of what Good Together is all about, is figuring out what would make you good together with whatever the situation is you're in.
Well, exactly. Like I said, it's twofold. First, you have to learn about yourself, and then you have to learn about the person you're looking for. And it's almost like I use a math equation. Mm-hmm. You're the first two. The other person is the other two. Well, 2 + 2 is going to equal 4. That's what it equals. Mm-hmm. Well, that's the relationship that you're targeting. Now, if you're a 2 and you want a 4 relationship, but the person you're matched to is a 3, guess what?
Problem.
You got a 5. Exactly.
Yeah.
You're not going to get there from here.
Or they're a 1. Problem.
Exactly. What, you know, whatever they are, if they're not what's right for that target relationship. So there's 3 parts that you have to know. You have to know yourself, you have to know the other person, and you have to know the relationship that the two of you want together. because you can't just get together with anyone and think that you're going to make this relationship.
Yeah. And that can apply in intimate relationships, a business relationship.
Absolutely.
You're a great business partner and business takes off, and then others where I can't make it work with my business partner.
Oh, absolutely. Like I say, this transcends all relationships. It's not specific to any one kind of relationships. You know, it means the same for all of them.
I like to say the light you put off is the moth you get.
Ah, that's excellent. I like that.
And
Thank you.
I'm thinking, Jerry, that you and I are kind of good together.
Oh, no doubt about that.
I say we go back to where we started.
Oh, that conversation was so good. I just...
Well, you know.
Stop right there. I need to savor those words.